Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Dead Time by William W. Johnstone and J. A. Johnstone. Narrated by A. T. Chandler. Chapter 1. The lousy coffee he had managed to drink for breakfast started rising from his gut when he stepped out of the prison wagon and saw the walls. Harry Fallon forced the coffee back down. He had seen prisons before, too damned many, thanks to Sean McGregor, president of the American Detective Agency in Chicago, Illinois. But the sight of the Texas State Penitentiary in Huntsville did something to his nerves. "Buck up," he told himself. "This is no different than Yuma or Jefferson City. And behind those walls, you're going to find the man or men who sent you to Joliet, but murdered." Fallon shuddered.
"She sure has a way of doing that to a feller," the deputy marshal drawled as he stepped up on Fallon's right. "Another feller once told me that the walls ain't no place to be."
The lawman snorted, laughed, and spit-chewing tobacco onto the cobblestone path cut into the spring grass and pine needles. The walls. 100,000 square feet surrounded by a foreboding wall of red brick, 15 feet high and 3 feet thick. And inside, hell on earth.
"Ready, Fallon?"
"Alexander," Fallon told the lawman in a tight, hard whisper. "Harry Alexander." The deputy cursed softly.
"Sorry," he whispered. "I knowed that. Just ain't good at this private detective business."
"Just don't slip once we're inside."
"Right.
Let's go." The chains hobbling his legs and wrists rattled as Fallon walked to the gate where beefy guards waited to welcome the latest inmate to the walls. Those red bricks, the stories went, got their color from the blood of every inmate to be sentenced to the prison since it had first opened in 1848.
"Warden,"
the deputy said, removing his hat as he stepped inside the dark office behind Fallon, whose manacles had been removed in the anteroom outside the gate. Another prison official shut the door behind Fallon and the deputy.
"Superintendent," the warden corrected. "According to the rules, regulations, and bylaws for the government and discipline of the Texas State Penitentiaries at Huntsville and Rusk, Texas."
He nodded at a four-shelf bookshelf to his left. One shelf held a Bible. The top shelf held what Fallon figured had to be rules, regulations, and bylaws. The rest of the case was empty. Fallon hoped the prison library had more books.
"Besides, I detest that vulgar word, warden, and Warden Walter Wilkinson has far too much alliteration."
The deputy stared in complete confusion. Alliteration would not be in his vocabulary, but Fallon considered him to be a good man, as long as he didn't forget to use Fallon's alias. Walter Wilkinson, warden. Personally, Fallon never cared much for the word superintendent. At the Texas State Pen, looked pretty much like every other warden Harry Fallon had known. Sweaty, pale, beady eyes, balding. In fact, Wilkinson was completely bald, whose handshake would be flabby had he dared lower himself to shake hands with a prisoner. Fallon already had the man pegged. A politician, he went to church to keep up appearances, took part in all the fairs, attended the meeting of men of power once a month, and used the underground tunnel that led from the hall to some classy brothel. He took bribes frequently, but not from prisoners. Prisoners didn't have enough clout or influence, let alone money.
"You've been a naughty, naughty young man,"
Wilkinson shook his head and muttered.
"Tisk, tisk."
He did not look up, but kept right on reading the file the American Detective Agency and the Texas Attorney General had prepared.
"A life sentence,"
Wilkinson tisk tisked again.
"Well, you'll be happy to know that when your life is over, we have a very fine graveyard for you."
He had a nasal voice, a heavy gut from too many mashed potatoes and port beer, and thick, dark, unruly eyebrows that contrasted with a bald head glistening from sweat.
"I suppose you're innocent, too,"
Fallon said. "Why would I be different than anyone else here?" The warden looked up. His eyes considered Fallon for a long time before he stepped back toward the window, leaned against the sill, and brought the tips of his fingers together.
"Actually," he said, "we have one prisoner who says he's guilty. You'll meet him eventually, if you live that long. The first night usually drives the weak ones to kill themselves, but..."
The fingertips parted and the warden shoved his hands into the deep pockets on his striped woolen trousers.
"I don't think you're weak, Harry Alexander."
He said the name as though he knew it was an alias, but in this part of the United States people were always choosing whatever name they wanted, and that wasn't because they were outlaws or running away from someone or something. Before he pinned on that badge in Fort Smith, Arkansas, Harry Fallon had cowboyed and hunted buffalo, and he had known cowboys and skinners who changed their names with the seasons, sometimes on a whim or bet, just to freshen things up. The warden nodded to the assistant who had been quietly standing near the door, and the deputy marshal who had escorted Fallon the 150 or 60 miles from Austin to Huntsville. Once the assistant signed a receipt and handed it to the deputy, the lawman looked at Fallon, nodded, thanked the warden, and opened the door. The assistant closed the heavy door behind the departing lawman, and Fallon slowly, discreetly, let out a long breath. So far, so good. The man in the dark uniform spoke in a dreary monotone, as though by rote. Fallon would be issued a uniform of white and brown stripes. This being summer, it was actually spring, but spring usually seemed like a figment of one's imagination in Texas. Fallon would be given shoes, pants, shirt, and hat. Socks, drawers, and a jacket would be provided in winter.
"If he's still alive," the warden said,
sniffed, and searched for a handkerchief in his coat pocket.
"You may keep any drawers, undershirts, socks, or handkerchiefs that you brought," the assistant said, "or may receive through friends or purchase them, but only after receiving permission from Superintendent Wilkinson, the assistant superintendent, or the sergeant."
Fallon learned about the bedding he would receive, how to handle mess call. Once again, no prisoners could speak while eating. Bathing once a week. Privileges, like Fallon would ever be granted any of those, visitations, punishments, and work details.
"Start him out tomorrow in the mill," the warden said.
The assistant went on. Fallon had heard it all before. Maybe one time Fallon thought he might hear it coming from someone who cared. Wouldn't that be something?
"Questions?" the warden asked.
"No, sir," Fallon answered.
"Peter,"
the warden had found his handkerchief and wiped his nose. Spring, Fallon realized. Hay fever. Fallon grinned. It was good to see a man like Walter Wilkinson suffer. Fallon had never been allergic to anything, though he wished he were allergic to prisons.
"Get him,"
the warden sneezed.
"Outfitted. Show him."
Another violent sneeze that almost doubled over the lout. This was only March. Wait till all the cedars started doing their damage, the wildflowers started blooming, and the winds picked up.
"His cell. Then..."
This time, the sneeze provoked a vile oath from the warden.
"Turn him over to Sergeant Drexel."
The assistant chuckled.
"Barney loves breaking in the fresh fish."
Every muscle in Fallon's body tightened. He had been inside the walls for no more than 30 minutes, and everything, all the planning they had spent, could be jeopardized. Fallon had mentioned the possible risk, but the Texas Attorney General and Sean McGregor had waved off his concerns.
"What would you say the chances are of you actually running into someone you know in Huntsville?"
McGregor had asked.
As a deputy marshal for Judge Parker in Arkansas and the Indian Nations, the man you sent to prison went to the Detroit House of Corrections.
I ran into them in Joliet, Fallon had reminded the Scot, and in Yuma, and in Jefferson City.
But Huntsville, Texas,
McGregor had scoffed. I cowboyed in Texas, Fallon had reminded him. A lot of men I chased out of the Nations rode south to Texas. The Attorney General hadn't bought that argument either.
The chances are slight, Malcolm Maxwell had said. And it's a risk you'll have to take,
Fallon had corrected him. You mean it's a risk I'll have to take.
If you want out, Fallon, McGregor had said, say the word.
He had spoken that so smugly, condescendingly, that Fallon had found himself grinding his teeth.
Say it, Fallon. There's always room for you at Joliet. Remember, this isn't just a chance to bring justice to a madman, to help your country. But more than that, this is your chance, your only chance, to write your name. To avenge the murders of your wife and daughter.
Now, thinking about that meeting, Fallon saw their faces then. His wife, Renee, so young, so beautiful. His daughter, Rachel, a sweetheart of a baby, who would be approaching young womanhood had she not. Fallon shuddered. The warden laughed, and the images before Fallon, those recurring, haunting memories, stopped instantly, bringing Fallon back into the office of the superintendent of the walls.
It happens all the time, doesn't it, Steve?
The assistant chuckled softly.
The walls have a way of sending a chill up your spine, especially when you know that you'll be here for the rest of your scum-sucking, miserable life.
The warden sneezed again.
No, no, not a life. You don't have a life anymore. You have an existence, and maybe that's only a figure of speech. Get him out!
Another violent sneeze rocked the warden, and the assistant, Steve, opened the door and nodded for Fallon to follow. Barney Drexel, Fallon kept thinking as he picked up his clothing, exchanging his denim pants, cotton shirt, and boots for the scratchy, ill-fitting summer uniform of white and brown stripes, rough shoes, and a cap that had to be one size too small. At least he had socks, relatively clean, and summer underpants. Those shoes would cripple a man without socks. Barney Drexel. Fallon hadn't thought of him since Judge Parker had fired the lout back in Fort Smith maybe 12 years back. Drexel had pinned on a badge after Parker had just been appointed as the only federal judge serving western Arkansas in the Indian Territory. Drexel had brought in most of the men he went after dead, but Fallon had also killed his share. The rule of outlaws in the Indian Nations was die game. Certainly, it beat hanging on the scaffolds outside of the old army building that now held the jail and the judge's courtroom. Even if sometimes you'd get to hang with your friends. Judge Parker's gallows could hold up to 6 doomed men at a time. Drexel should have wound up on those gallows himself. He shot another deputy marshal dead while both were off duty in a saloon on Garrison Avenue. Put 4 45 caliber slugs into Deputy Marshal Flint Logan's stomach and another in the back of Logan's head while he lay in a pool of his own blood on the saloon's sawdust-covered floor. He would have put another bullet in Logan's corpse, but the Colt misfired the last chamber. That shooting had not surprised Fallon. Drexel had always been a brute and a bully and too often went for his Colt or Winchester. What saved Drexel from the gallows was the fact that Flint Logan's reputation also smelled like a coyote's carcass, and witnesses couldn't or wouldn't say that Drexel drew first. The argument seemed to be over a prostitute, but she couldn't be found after the shooting. The U.S. Marshal, U.S. Attorney, and Judge Parker agreed that they had rid the U.S. Marshal's service of 2 bad apples. Flint Logan was dead. Barney Drexel was told not to show his face in Arkansas or the Indian Nations again. So Drexel had wound up as a sergeant of guards in Huntsville. Such was Harry Fallon's luck. He made it through the prison doctor's evaluation in rapid time.
"You seem to attract a lot of bullets, sir," the bony, white-haired old-timer said.
"And knives," Fallon told him. "Clubs, broken bottles, fists, hatchets, fingernails.
I've performed autopsies on bodies with fewer scars. Take a deep breath. Exhale."
The doctor lowered the stethoscope.
"You're in remarkable condition for what should be a corpse. Have a peppermint stick, Mr. Alexander, and welcome to the walls."
Now he had been turned over to a guard, a red-headed man with a thick mustache and blackened teeth. As the guard escorted Fallon across the prison yard toward Sergeant Barney Drexel, Fallon kept thinking that maybe, just maybe, after all these years, Drexel wouldn't recognize him. A dozen years had passed, and 10 of those years had been hard, brutally hard, on Harry Fallon. The Illinois State Prison at Joliet certainly had earned its reputation for aging a man.
"Sergeant Drexel," the black-toothed guard said. "Fresh fish for you."
Big, ugly, bearded Barney Drexel turned around and wrapped a big stick into the palm of his beefy left hand. Barney Drexel looked the same. Fallon muttered a curse under his breath, but he was saved by another savage curse. His escort stopped and stepped aside. Fallon turned toward the curse and saw a man in the uniform of a Huntsville inmate running hard.
"You turncoat yellowbelly,"
the man said as his lowered shoulder caught Fallon's middle. Chapter 2. Josh Riker. Fallon recognized him just before the wiry one-time cowboy knocked the breath out of him. Landing hard on his back, Fallon managed to bring his knees up, and then he kept rolling, somersaulting, sending Riker sailing toward Sergeant Barney Drexel and the other guards and inmates gathered around the whipping post. Josh Riker, the last person Fallon expected to find in Huntsville. Who else could be here? Not that it mattered. What had Fallon expected the American Detective Agency to do? Go through a list of every inmate housed in the state pen and see if Fallon recognized the names? Hell, half the men Fallon had arrested in the Indian Nations in Arkansas had been using aliases. Fallon rolled to his side, pushed himself up on elbows and knees, trying to get his lungs to work again. He heard cheers, curses, and shouts coming from inmates who now provided a wide arena for the fight. Maybe some of the guards were cheering, too. Fallon also saw Josh Riker running toward him. Fallon let him come. At the last second, he dived to his right, lifted his left leg high, and managed to trip Riker. The man cursed as he went sailing into a wall of men in brown and white or black and white uniforms. The prisoner shoved Riker back into the circle. He fell onto his back, spread-eagled, and slowly came up, shaking the cobwebs out of his head. By then, Fallon had pushed himself to his feet. He stood, waiting.
"Go get him!" an inmate shouted. "Kill him! Stomp his head into the dirt!"
Fallon shook his own head. He wasn't moving. He was still trying to remember how to breathe. And the spectators in prison uniforms and guard uniforms weren't all cheering for the fresh fish.
"Riker, you's a fightin' like a Baptist deacon's wife. Get off your ass, you puny sack of snake turds, and kill this new meat."
Riker came to his feet, turned, staggered, straightened, and began moving cautiously, ready now. He probably expected Fallon to be the young green pup he had been back during their cowboying days, back when they had first arrived in Fort Smith. Riker was the older of the two. The one who could outdrink, outfight, and outride anyone he ever met. Fallon had been the tag-along kid still in his teens and wet behind the ears. Now Riker knew that 15 years had hardened his one-time pard. "He doesn't know the half of it," Fallon thought as he brought his arms up, fists clenched, and began countering Riker's feints as he drew closer. 10 years in Joliet for a crime I didn't commit. The riots, the knifings, The weeks in solitary and the whippings just so the guards could let everyone know who bossed the prison. And then pardoned by the governor only to find myself back in prison, this time working for the American Detective Agency. Yeah, that'll harden a man until his skin and fists are like iron, and his soul and heart even harder than that. Yuma, in Arizona Territory, known rightfully so as the Hellhole, Jefferson City in Missouri, called the bloodiest 47 acres in America. And now inside these god-awful walls in eastern Texas. Yeah, Fallon wasn't that kid Riker had punched longhorns with in Texas, Indian Territory, and Kansas. Wasn't that puppy dog who had followed Riker to Fort Smith to gamble. Riker swung a right, an easy punch to avoid. Fallon felt it pass over his head, and he came up quickly, bending his head so that the back of his skull caught Riker's jaw. He heard the crunch of teeth and saw Riker fall backward. Fallon straightened, shaking off the pain in his head, and raised his right foot. He slammed the ill-fitting shoe down toward Riker's bleeding face, but Josh Riker wasn't the same youthful cowboy Fallon had ridden with from Dodge City to Fort Smith all those years ago. Yes, Riker had learned a few things, too. He grabbed Fallon's foot, twisted it, and sent Fallon spinning into the ground. Now Fallon rolled into the feet and legs of the prisoners who had formed a circle to watch the brawl. They kicked him, hissed at him, and rolled him back toward Riker. Fallon turned and rose off the ground just in time to feel Riker's kick that caught him in the left shoulder and drove him into the dust and sand. Fallon brought his legs up again, catching the diving Riker, and once again sent the cowboy sailing. Again, Fallon rose quickly, rubbing his shoulder, already feeling the beginnings of a big, painful bruise. But his collarbone hadn't been broken.
"Quarter pound of tobacco, says a fresh fish takes that little punk. Bet. I'll let you see that tin top of that whore I met in San Angelo if Riker loses this fight.
I've seen that picture. I never want to see it again. Give me nightmares, it did."
18 months, Fallon remembered. That had been Riker's sentence. The scenes replayed in Fallon's head. They had been drunk, Fallon and Riker, not an unusual state for those two young fools. Pretty much cleaned out by Fort Smith's gamblers, they had been shooting out the street lamps the first time, only to be stopped by a man that Fallon guessed to be a preacher. The stranger turned out to be Judge Isaac Parker. Fallon should have learned then that Riker wasn't the type of saddle pal you wanted to be with. For a moment, Fallon thought Riker would murder the judge, and maybe he would have had a lawman not come along then. $50 or 50 days. Riker had to sell his horse and saddle to get them out of the Fort Smith calaboose, then lost most of what he had left over in a craps game, and decided to steal a saddle on display at a saddle shop. Fallon had tried to stop Riker. Riker wasn't one to be stopped. They had fought. Riker had won. And then another lawman came around, and after an insane and intense few seconds, Fallon had stopped his bard from murdering the lawman in cold blood. The lawman, whose life Fallon had saved, was a deputy U.S. Marshal for Judge Parker's court. When Fallon had been brought to the judge's office, there had been no plea deal. Nothing like that. The judge and the U.S. Marshal, after hearing how Fallon had saved a deputy's life, offered Fallon a job.
"It's not a gift," Judge Parker had warned him.
And it most certainly wasn't. Fallon had moved up from driving a prison wagon for deputy marshals to becoming a federal deputy himself, one of the youngest and best in Parker's court. Till that all came crumbling down. Josh Riker had spent 18 months at the Detroit House of Corrections for assault on a federal lawman. He could have gotten more had the state pressed for charges of breaking and entering, attempted burglary, and unlawful discharge of a firearm. Well, Fallon thought as the convicts and guards cursed and cheered, he couldn't really blame Riker. From the look of the inmate, life had never turned out the way the gambling, foolhardy cowboy had thought it would. Detroit was the first step. Now he was in Huntsville,
Why don't the guards stop this?
Fallon threw a punch, ducked another, as the cheers and curses grew louder. The dust blinded him. He answered his own question.
They wouldn't have stopped it in Joliet, Yuma, or Jeff City. They wouldn't have stopped it in the dungeon in Fort Smith where men awaited trial, unless it got out of hand. Huntsville's no different.
His nose was bleeding, so were his lips. His back hurt and shoulder throbbed. He swung, missed, ducked, swung again, connected, felt a punch that almost took off his right ear, and responded with one that Riker deflected. Riker brought his prison shoes down hard on Fallon's right foot. Fallon wrapped his arm around Riker's neck and drew it close. He tried to flatten Riker's nose, but Riker caught the wrist and held it tight, trying to twist it off. The men grunted, squirmed, attempted to break free, but neither man was willing to give.
"Hell, they ain't doing nothing but waltzing," a Texas accent drawled.
Fallon didn't know if that came from a guard or an inmate.
"No mas! No mas!"
a Mexican prisoner shouted. Riker tried to spit in Fallon's face. His breath stank of bad tobacco and worse coffee. He was missing several teeth, scars cut through his once handsome face. But, well, after all those years of hard time, Fallon wasn't going to win any beauty contests himself.
"Been waiting," Riker heaved. "A long time for this."
Fallon said nothing. Riker's grip was so tight on his wrist, he felt his hand growing numb. They weaved this way and that. The shouts and curses sounded all around them, but by now the dust was so thick, the sweat stinging his eyes, Fallon couldn't see much beyond Riker's bloody, sweaty, grimacing face.
"I read about your kid and wife," Riker said.
His eyes gleamed. He laughed, which was all Fallon needed.
"You're a soft-hearted kid, Hank," a deputy marshal once told him in Fort Smith. "Too nice for this job, I often think. But when you get riled, it's like I don't even know who you are no more."
Josh Riker now saw what Fallon was like when he was riled. Fallon's knee came up, caught Riker hard in the groin. The grip relaxed and Fallon broke free and slammed his flattened palm against Riker's throat. The inmate's eyes bulged as he tried to breathe. Had Fallon hit harder, Riker would be dying, but Fallon had not lost all control. He had just lost his temper. He slammed a right into Riker's jaw, buried a left into the man's gut. When Riker doubled over, Fallon brought up his knee again, catching the man in the mouth, smashing his lips, knocking out two more teeth. Fallon reached with his left, grabbed Riker's shirt, hoping to pull him up and keep pounding his face until it was nothing but an unrecognizable pulp. But the cotton ripped, and Riker fell into the dust. He was lying still when Fallon landed on top of him. He swung a left, a right, again, again, and again. Then he felt the stick of a guard against his skull, and Fallon rolled off the now unconscious Riker. Fallon saw stars first, then dust, and finally a burly, bearded face just above him. Chapter 3. It was a face that Fallon recognized, but this time it was a welcome sight. Aaron Holderman, another ex-convict Fallon had once put away but now an operative for the American Detective Agency, waved the nightstick over Fallon, then bent down and jerked Fallon to his feet.
"Drexel," Fallon managed in a strained whisper. "Knows me."
At first, Fallon couldn't tell if Holderman, not the keenest mind in the detective business, heard him or understood him. And if he did hear and understand, Fallon realized he might not have cared one whit. Fallon had never trusted Holderman, for too many damned good reasons to count. But this time, in this operation, Fallon had no other choice. Holderman heard Fallon, however, for he balled his massive right hand into a fist and slammed it into Fallon's face, breaking the nose, sending blood gushing from his nostrils. The big brute roared,
"Take that, you son of a—"
"Holderman," said another voice,
That's enough.
Through the pain, the ringing in his ears, Fallon knew that voice too. Barney Drexel.
Get up,
Holderman said, and Fallon felt himself being jerked to his feet. Blood continued gushing, and Holderman brought his left hand up and smeared the blood all over Fallon's face. When Sean McGregor and his son Dan had started explaining the plan to Fallon back in Chicago, Fallon wasn't sure it would ever work. He especially didn't like the thought of Aaron Holderman being sent into Huntsville undercover, taking on the role of a prison guard. Fallon had worked with Holderman in Yuma and Jefferson City. Even if Fallon trusted the big lout, Fallon certainly didn't think that Holderman was smart enough to pull off the job of a prison guard. Now Fallon realized he had been wrong. Aaron Holderman might not be the brightest man Fallon had ever known. That's why they had told him to use his own name. He'd never remember his alias. But he had played everything perfectly. Holderman shoved Fallon toward Sergeant Barney Drexel.
Watch it, you damned fool, Barney bellowed at Holderman. I don't want to get blood on my uniform. Damn, what a bloody mess, Drexel chuckled. Who's a fresh fish?
The guard who had escorted Fallon into the prison yard produced the paper.
Harry Alexander, Drexel read. Life sentence.
He crumpled the paper and tossed it back to the guard.
Well, Mr. Harry Alexander, you might as well know how things work at Huntsville since you'll be here maybe a long time, maybe a few days, till the end of your pathetic life.
Fallon lowered his head, letting the blood pool in the dust between his miserable prison shoes. God bless Aaron Holderman, he thought. Any chance Drexel would have recognized me ended when that big galoot broke my nose. At the very least, Holderman had bought Fallon some more time. That time was about to grow.
Fighting is not allowed in Huntsville. We don't even have a boxing club for prisoners. But we'll give you some time to think about all you've done wrong here today, and maybe by that time your nose will have stopped bleeding.
He stepped back, glanced at Riker, and shook his head again.
A dozen lashes for Riker, Barney Drexel ordered. As soon as he wakes up, then get him to the hospital. Give that old sawbone something to do. A dozen days for the fresh fish. What's his name again? Alexander. Harry Alexander. Introduce Harry Alexander to the sweat box. Let's make it an even 2 weeks, though. He's got 14 days to think about all the things he shouldn't have done. Meditate on how you got here, fresh fish.
Fallon felt strong hands grab his upper arms. Still weak, in agony, his feet dragged over the dust, even over Josh Riker's legs, as he came to another dungeon. The heavy iron door was opened by two men, and Fallon felt himself hurtled into the box. He saw the slop bucket, a blanket, and a jar of water. Hitting the floor hard, he rolled over just before the iron door slammed shut, putting Fallon into a black void. Solitary confinement. The black box. Sweat box. For 2 damned weeks. He had plenty of time to think now. In the darkness and the tight confines of the sweat box, Fallon could think. He had thought a lot. There was much he could remember, some he wanted to, some he had to, some he hated to recall. Like sitting in that foul-smelling, dark-as-night office on the top floor of that brownstone building in Chicago.
Have you ever been to Huntsville?
Sean McGregor had asked. He puffed on the cigar. His hair, what he had left, was mostly orange, but the silver was rapidly gaining ground, and his eyes were a dead green. That was about the only color you could find in McGregor's office except for Fallon's clothes. Everything around Fallon appeared to be brown, and once again the curtains were closed. Only a little light came from the lamp and trickled through the cracks in the curtains.
Illinois? Fallon asked,
or Alabama. The little man slowly removed the cigar from his mouth and set the repugnant stogie on the ashtray. His eyes narrowed and he answered angrily,
Texas.
Sean McGregor knew that Harry Fallon knew that his boss meant Texas, and Fallon knew he knew.
Oh, Fallon said. Didn't Jesse James rob some bank or train or paymaster in Huntsville, Alabama?
Jesse James is dead. Frank James is retired and an outstanding shoe salesman or race starter or something along those lines.
Fallon nodded, and that movement hurt. No, Fallon got around to answering. Huntsville's over in East Texas, in what they call the Piney Woods. When I drove cattle, the trails were farther west.
You know what's in Huntsville, Texas, don't you?
The aches started to intensify. Fallon had just gotten out of the prison in Jefferson City, Missouri. Before that, Sean McGregor had sent him to Yuma Territorial Prison in the hell on earth that was Southern Arizona Territory. Fallon had thought that assignment was something like some gin-guzzling writer of dime novels would plot. Get arrested, sent to the hellhole, befriend, or at the least, join up with that crazed killer monk Quinn who had robbed a Southern Pacific train of some $200,000 worth of gold bullion. Escape the prison with Quinn, follow him into Mexico, find that stolen gold and return it, along with Quinn and his companions, dead, hopefully, but alive if there was no preventing that. Let the American Detective Agency, make that Sean McGregor, enjoy the glory and the rewards of a successful operation. The Jefferson City assignment had seemed equally asinine. Go back to another prison, that ninth circle of hell called the Missouri State Penitentiary, once again as a convicted felon. Get friendly with another inmate, a pregnant young woman who happens to be married to a bank-robbing scoundrel trying to better everything the James Younger, Dalton, and Reno gangs ever did, and find out where he's hiding his stolen loot. Of course, no one could have foreseen a riot breaking out and Fallon barely getting out of there alive. Sean McGregor had angrily repeated his question.
I don't suppose, Fallon answered, that you mean Sam Houston's grave.
Don't be a fool, Fallon turned, not showing his surprise that the comment came from neither Aaron Holderman nor Sean McGregor, but the agency president's son, Dan, who sat next to big, bruising Holderman in the dark office. This is serious, Dan McGregor said. Fallon looked back at the elder McGregor. So it's back to prison, he said. The tiny man nodded his child-sized head. A sigh slowly escaped and Fallon leaned back in his chair. It could have been worse, he guessed. The Detroit House of Corrections, for instance, where he figured scores of prisoners would love to send a one-time federal marshal to meet his maker. Or back to Joliet, which the McGregors and Holderman had often threatened, to return Fallon for the duration of your sentence. He had been paroled from Joliet after saving some lives during a violent, ugly riot. According to what he had been told, Fallon was supposed to attend church services on Sundays. The minister was to report to the parole board and the Joliet warden that Fallon had attended. He was not to drink intoxicating spirits. He could not gamble in public venues or private ones. He was not supposed to associate with known gamblers or any former convict, which always made Fallon look at Aaron Holderman, whom Fallon had sent to prison. He was supposed to be working at Werner's Wheelwright in Chicago and staying at Mrs. Ketchum's boarding house near Lake Michigan. Those had been the non-negotiable conditions of his parole. Fallon had never met Mr. Werner or spent one night in Mrs. Ketchum's boarding house. No one had served him with an arrest warrant yet, probably because Fallon had been doing time in the worst prisons in America. And now he was going back to one. He had worked with buffalo hunters, buffalo skinners, cowboys, and even deputy United States marshals who had been well acquainted with the state pen, the walls, in the heavily forested city of Huntsville, Texas. They all said the same thing. That place will put the fear of God into the most ardent atheist. All right, Fallon said. Let's hear it. Inside the sweat box, Sweat, the box had been aptly named, burned his cuts, blinded his eyes, not that he had anything to see, and soaked his clothes. He reached over blindly for the ladle, dipped it inside the pitcher, and brought out tepid water. He drank, wanted more, but understood that more would likely sicken him, and the sweat box would just make the odor of his vomit more, hell, nauseating. He returned the ladle and began fingering the slices of bread scattered about his sides. When he had first entered Joliet, an old trustee had warned him not to eat the bread if he ever wound up in solitary confinement.
That'll just make you more and more thirsty. Man don't need bread. Well, man in solitary don't need bread, lessen they keep you in for an eternity. Then you ain't got no choice buts to eat it. So just drinks the water, sir, lessen you ain't got no other choice.
He counted. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. His hands kept patting. 5. That's it. He cursed and found another flint-like thin slice. 6. 6 days. 6 days on water. Oh, they gave him bread, but it had to be at least a week old, hard as the iron walls in the sweat box. But moldy, too. Fallon's teeth had been loosened from surviving innumerable scrapes in Yuma and Jefferson City, let alone Joliet, and his gums were prone to bleeding. Live off the food you got in prison, then in the deserts of Mexico, and Fallon figured he was maybe 2 jumps ahead of scurvy. His teeth couldn't handle what passed for bread here. He swore, gagged at the stench from the slop bucket, and heard the sounds from above. This time it wasn't the screams from a prisoner as he was whipped by one of the brutes that called themselves guards. It wasn't the pounding of fists as one inmate wailed another. It was laughter. A guard was telling a joke to prisoners as they exercised by throwing a ball around. Laughter. That would drive even the hardest man insane, and Fallon knew. That's why they were doing it. Breaking in the fresh fish. Seeing just how tough he was. Fallon's hands worked again, finding the rock-hard slices of stale, repulsive bread. He hoped, prayed, that he had miscounted. 5, 6. He hadn't. 6 days. 6 days, he thought. 2 weeks. How many days are in a week? God, I can't. 7. He sighed. He felt like crying. He had 8 more days. 8 more days. He couldn't make it. He'd... No, he remembered. He steeled himself, clenched both hands into tight fists. Damn right he would make it. He had a reason. He remembered again. He had to. Had to get his mind away from where he was, take him back weeks, months, even years later. He had to recall everything. Had to remember that he was Harry Alexander now, not Harry Fallon. He had to remember, no matter how much the memories might hurt. Chapter 4. Have you ever heard of Josiah Jonathan Justice? Dan McGregor had asked. They had left Sean McGregor in his darkness and crossed the hallway to a smaller, brighter office. That's where Fallon first met Malcolm Maxwell, Attorney General for the state of Texas. Fallon's head shook, which left him cringing, the pain reminding him of how he had barely gotten out of the state pen in Missouri alive, and now he was going back to another brutal prison.
Cotton magnate, Maxwell, a slim, balding man, said in a Texas accent. Sugar cane, too. He is based in Natchitoches, Louisiana, though he's from the city of Houston, Texas, originally, and lives there. if you believe this, part-time to escape the heat of Louisiana. The Texan had an engaging grin. But his operations spread from Pensacola, Florida to Corpus Christi, Texas, and he's not limited to farming on his plantations. He has some cattle ranches in South Texas, part interest in a shipping line that's based in Corpus Christi. Fallon waited. The last time he had checked, there was no law against growing cotton or sugar cane or diversifying into other businesses. Filthy rich, Dan McGregor said, which wasn't against the law either. He commanded his own regiment during the war between the states, the attorney general continued. Justice's Legion supplied his own artillery. You might have heard of them. Fallon hadn't. Unlike a lot of Southerners, the war didn't hurt him. After the surrender, he went back into business, using sharecroppers instead of slaves, paying them a pittance. Fallon sipped coffee, set the cup on a tray resting on a side table, and looked at the younger McGregor and the Texas official. So why am I going to Huntsville? Colonel Justice has found labor that's even cheaper than former slaves, the attorney general said. Have you heard of leasing? Leasing what? Inmates, Malcolm Maxwell answered. Fallon cocked his head. It's similar to what you experienced in Joliet and even Jefferson City, Dan McGregor explained. Fallon had been put inside the broom factory at Jefferson City, though he didn't think anything he tried to make would have satisfied his mother when it came to sweeping, and he had done various jobs inside the Illinois State Pen. With one exception, McGregor continued, the inmates aren't working within the prison walls. According to state law, the attorney general said, with consent of the penitentiary board and the superintendent, inmates can be hired out. It's a winner in theory. The state gets money from the factories or railroads or plantation owners and farmers. The prisoners learn a trade. The person hiring the inmates gets cheap, real cheap labor. You want me to get hired by Justice? Fallon said. Exactly, the attorney general said. You fill the bill of what Justice has been hiring. You're a Southerner from Arkansas. Missouri, Fallon corrected. Gad's Hill, which leaned more blue than gray. That's Harry Fallon, McGregor said with a smile. You'll be Harry Alexander, fought with the irregulars between Little Rock and the Missouri border, those that hid out in the Devil's Den. And you'll be entering Huntsville with a life sentence, Maxwell said. Surely they don't allow men with life sentences to be leased out to anyone, Fallon said. Both men nodded. The attorney general picked up a small book, flipped through a few pages, and adjusted his spectacles as he read. No convict shall be hired out or sent to an outside camp who was convicted of rape for a greater term than 10 years or who has a particularly bad reputation for lawlessness, or whom the penitentiary physician may pronounce physically unable to perform the labor required of him. The life sentence means you're one bad hombre, and that's what Justice is looking for. But your sentence shall be reduced to 10 years, McGregor said. These files on you in the prison superintendent's office will say you have been an exemplary inmate, like many other prisoners who have had a remarkable turnaround. Maxwell said, removed his spectacles, and began cleaning them with a handkerchief as he rolled his eyes. Fallon woke, the light blinding him, and felt the slop bucket being removed, the water pitcher being refilled, and the slice of bread being dropped onto his shirt. "He's still breathing, boss," the trustee said as he dropped a new, empty slop bucket in the corner. "That's a quarter pound of tobacco you owe me," the guard said. The door slammed shut. Blackness returned. Fallon picked up the bread, placed it at his side, and counted the slices again. 8. How long can a man survive without food? A month would be on the top end, maybe longer, depending on his condition physically and mentally. A week on the low end. As long as he had water, Fallon reached for the pitcher and drank. A voice from outside in the daylight, glorious daylight, reached him.
Connors, Superintendent Wilkinson wants to see you.
Connors. The name meant nothing to Fallon. Inmate, maybe. Guard, perhaps. Wilkinson. Oh yes, he knew Wilkinson. Warden, superintendent was too classy a title for a man like Warren Wilkinson at the walls. A former executive with the National Pinkerton Detective Agency. That's why Sean McGregor had taken the case. That little man would do anything to discredit his major rival in the private investigation business. He thought back. Pensacola, Florida was sweltering, and this was what most people called spring. Fallon had gotten used to the Midwest climate of Joliet, even though the past months had found him in Arizona Territory, Mexico, and hot and humid Missouri.
"Remember, Master Hank," the old black man had said. "I know that machete is big, and you probably be used to swinging it, but you don't swing nothing on no sugar cane, sir. You gots to saw it real gentle, close to the ground."
The chute fell, and Fallon picked it up and laid it into the wheelbarrow, then mopped his brow with the sleeve of his shirt.
"That's right, sir. You getting it now real fine, Master Hank. If and they put you somewheres else, you remembers what to do."
"Strip the cane," Fallon said. He was dying for a drink of water. "No leaves, just a green shoot. Use my hands, maybe a knife."
"Like that?"
The big man grinned as he pointed at the machete. "No, something smaller."
"Right. Now this ain't the best time to be doing no harvesting."
"Fall," Fallon said. "But in Louisiana and other places, you can get a couple of growing seasons."
"Right. Then you can cut the shoots into smaller sizes. It's right good eating, Master Hank. Right good. So we wouldn't be harvesting this here cane, except that's what the boss man says."
Fallon rose, leaving the machete on the ground, and rubbed his aching back. Why couldn't Mr. Justice have gone into some other kind of business? Something less painful, like breaking wild mustangs, or wrestling wild boars or even grizzly bears.
"So how you knows when de cane be ready to get harvested, Master Hank?"
Fallon again wiped away sweat. "The leaves will be." The heat and the sun baked his brain and he had to think, but the old Negro was patient.
"Dry, maybe yellow." "That's good, Master Hank. You gonna be a top hand come next harvest time. If in this job they's teaching you for don't pan out, you come on back down here to Pensacola. I'll let my boss man know how good you is. Then maybe we go fishing. You like grouper? Nothing better, Master Hank, than fried grouper on my missus' bread."
Fallon hoped that meant his lesson was over, but the black man was one tough teacher.
"What else can you tell me about how to say when it's time to start sawing down cane, Master Hank?"
Groaning, Fallon lowered himself into the muddy ground, picked up the machete, and tapped the side of the blade softly against a growing cane. "The sound," he answered. "If it's ready, it'll sound different."
"That's right good. Sound like metal again metal. Ain't making that sound now, on account that it ain't time to do no harvesting. And there's one other way, ain't there?"
Fallon nodded. He made the motion of cutting sideways into a chute.
"It'll shine. Glisten." "That's right. You's real smart, Master Hank. That shine comes from the sugar. Sweet it is. Now, you come on back to my shack. I bet my missus has some cane syrup that we can pour over your flapjacks."
11. Fallon sucked in a deep breath and slowly exhaled. 11 days. He had been sentenced to 12. He groaned, remembering again. Barney Drexel had originally given Fallon 12 days, but extended it to a full 2 weeks. This was day 12, though. Fallon thought he might just live through it. But he had lived through the sugarcane plantation in Florida. He had marched across the cotton fields in Mobile, Alabama. And he had met with Malcolm Maxwell one more time in New Orleans.
"I know this undercover spy business isn't your cup of tea," the Texas Attorney General had said.
They were in the politician's berth on a stern wheeler, the Texan, Fallon, Dan McGregor, and Aaron Holderman. "You haven't told me what you think justice is doing," Fallon said. "We wanted to see if you could pass muster in the sugarcane fields first," Dan McGregor said.
"From what Dan says," Malcolm Maxwell said, "you'll find no trouble getting a job."
Fallon did not laugh. The silence caused the Texan to clear his throat.
"We don't know exactly what justice is doing, but we fear it could be devastating to Texas and our country."
"I'm really not interested in Texas or my country," Fallon said, and he stared hard at Dan McGregor. "All I want is the man or men who killed my wife and daughter, and put me in Joliet for something I didn't do." "You killed him already, Fallon," Holderman said. "In Jeff City." Fallon knew that. A few officials at the Missouri Pen had come up with a brilliant plan, murder for hire. And the murderers were inmates at Jefferson City. They'd go out through an old escape tunnel, kill some politician, or... Fallon frowned with bitterness and clenched his fists. A young wife and a little girl. That killer had been a man known at the Missouri State Pen as the Mole. But Fallon couldn't hate him because the murderer had become a shell of a man, and when he died, he probably did not even remember killing any mother and child. And the Mole had saved Fallon's life. "The man who sent the Mole to do it," Fallon snapped. "That's who I want." "We think it's probably someone working at the walls," Dan McGregor said.
"You think?"
"It's complicated, Fallon," the Attorney General told Fallon.
"We don't know what justice has planned, but he's using inmates at the walls to help him."
"Cutting sugar cane, picking cotton," Fallon rolled his eyes.
"No," the Attorney General said. "Robbery, murder, treason."
Fallon sank back into the settee. He sipped the potent chicory folks called coffee in this part of Louisiana.
6 months ago, an army caravan was robbed on the way to Fort Clark," Maxwell explained. "Springfield rifles, Colt revolvers, and ammunition were stolen and taken into Mexico, where they disappeared. The bandits were dressed as Mexicans. That close to the border, it made sense, and Mexico is always in turmoil. So is the north side of the Rio Grande. But an officer said he recognized one of the bandits and that he was not Mexican. His name was Cole Hansen."
Maxwell paused. "I've heard the name," Fallon said. "Texas hard case."
"Who was serving a 10-year sentence at the time of the robbery. 6 more years to go. At the walls."
Fallon waited. Dan McGregor answered. The commanding general for the Department of Texas laughed down the captain's report. Superintendent Wilkinson then announced that Cole Hansen had died of pneumonia at the prison hospital 4 days before the robbery.
"So your captain was mistaken," Fallon said, though he didn't believe it.
"I believe," the attorney general said, "that if we dug up that pine box in the prison cemetery, we'd find an empty pine box."
"Dig it up," Fallon said.
"That would tip our hand," McGregor said.
"You don't have a hand," Fallon told him.
"At least, not a winning hand."
"That's why we've thrown you into the deck," Dan McGregor grinned.
"Wilkinson has ties with the Missouri State Penitentiary," the Texas general said.
Fallon stiffened. "That doesn't mean he had your wife and daughter killed, Hank," McGregor pointed out.
"But he's a mighty big suspect,
Aaron Holderman said and spit tobacco juice into a fancy cuspidor.
Shut up, McGregor said.
Wilkinson also has ties with the Pinkertons, Malcolm Maxwell said. That's why the Pinkertons would not take the case.
And it's why Sean McGregor did, Fallon said. He had wondered why the Texan hadn't gone to the Pinkertons. Now he knew. He drank more strong coffee, found a pastry on a silvered dish, took the pastry and bit into it. Once he had swallowed, he crossed his legs. So your rich man Justice is getting richer by robbing guns from the army, probably selling them to some revolutionary down in Mexico or even the Mexican government.
Josiah Justice is ruthless and ambitious and just damned evil, Maxwell said. But we don't think he's doing all this for money.
Then what? Fallon asked. To start another civil war, McGregor answered. Here, in the South. When that finally sank in, Fallon said,
That's insane.
Which also describes Josiah Jonathan Justice to a T,
Attorney General Malcolm Maxwell said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.